It's not always that every Saturday we have Pastor David, but it seems to be quite a flow so far, because sometimes you're away during that time in your mission trip. But praise God, today I've asked Pastor David to share whatever God has placed in his heart, ministry and everything, whatever the Lord has for us, so that we can be blessed by his ministry. And at the end of it, if there's anything to add, we'll add, and then we'll minister to each one of you. Praise God. So let's give Jesus a good clap offering as we have Pastor David coming to share with us. And whenever he comes, usually Shama is around, and usually the three generals around, and plus all church angels. So praise God. You know, watch out, you know, for all those things that are happening behind the background with him. Amen.
Thank you. Well, you know, this trip coming back from Russia has been quite an experience. And then we talk about the cube dimension. How instead of, we were both expecting another Madaba type of experience where 7 days or, you know, of vision and then downloading. But this time round was a different download. This time round was not one vision, but a software given to me with a password. It's something like that. I mean, that's how we can describe the thing. I think I did mention when I was in Vladivostok. Vladivostok. Okay lah. Then I was walking along the overhead bridge, and then suddenly lah, Shama. I mean, I was quite tired. It was just landed, 9 hours never sleep because of the old man. Then suddenly Shama say, "Open your eyes and see." And I didn't expect. You know, suddenly I was in a cube type of a assistance, I would say. And then six dimensions of vision happening at the same time. And I was looking, and I you know, the vision was below me. I was just floating, and then I had to grab the railing, you know. I was getting groggy because it was suddenly, and I was feeling vertigo, and I was about to vomit because it was so overwhelming. So it lasted for nearly about 2 minutes. And good thing I was alone on the overhead bridge, so no one was there. So if anyone was there, they would say, drunken. Because I was, wow. I wanted to go down, but the vision is there. I also don't want to go down. I'll go in there also or not, you know. Then I was looking around. Then the moment I turned back, because behind there was another vision. When I turned back, wow, that vertigo was very bad because I twisted. But I saw it was a vision of Christ and the apostles, so this is the vision that I had. So when I came back and then we talked, we were expecting another 26 hours of camping. I brought my toothbrush and toothpaste to his house, you know. But then it turned out, hey, no, what here? I say, I don't feel that it was like Madaba or a lot of images. So he said, so we work it out, and then he said it was a software. And all these six planes are all in the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You know, so there is the plane that is above. I see the heavenly realm. The one in front I saw, it was the Madaba vision, so foundation of the earth, so chapter 1. Chapter 2, the heavenly realm, then chapter 3, revelation of mysteries. On the left one was the vision of things to come. Okay, then on the right one, chapter 6, the spirit realm, the angelic and the evil spirit dimension. Behind chapter 4, speak about the apostles and Christ and the apostles. Then the vision below, chapter 5, speak of our the church, present day church. So yesterday was the first time I was given the liberty to sleep during overnight prayer. So someone asked me, hey, khun kao ko bo khun dio la. It was testing la, because when I was in pastor's house, we did it and it was very smooth. Somehow I just went into rest, and then straight away I had some vision. I saw the Lord Jesus Christ, I saw Mary. But yesterday took me some time because the seat was also a bit uncomfortable. So when I went into the cube already, my neck was twisted. When I came out, I said, "Oh, sing me." So the second time round, I went there better. I can stretch out my leg. So, but one of the things I experienced yesterday was, you see, I have come. We are learning slowly what this gift given to us. I'm learning that Shama is the administrator. The Holy Spirit is the controller. Okay? I'm just the one receiving, and so yesterday there was, I thought Shama would initiate, but then no, it was the Holy Spirit, who spoke to me, and then it was Holy Spirit to instruct Shama to take me out. I was in the cube, but take me in the spirit, into the vision on our present day one. And I came, I was in a cube. I was brought into that vision. Then I came into our midst. And I was able to see every one of you, those of you who were here last night, your spirit man. I was able to discern your spirit man. And one of the things I encouraged last night after the overnight prayer was, believe in that. We have proclaimed Isaiah 60 verse 1. Say, "Arise, for your light has risen, and the light of God's glory has risen upon you. Therefore, arise." Because why? Over the last 2 months, and you have been receiving a lot of anointing, and that has been deposited into your spirit, man. You may not feel it physically yet, but it is a deposit into your spirit, man. And when I saw each one of you in your spirit, it was bright. There is that light growing in you. The vision I saw of Jesus, even when he was a small boy, in the spirit, right, he was so bright. There were so many archangels with him, many angels surrounding him, always with him. And he attracted, wherever he went, he attracted angels. It was just like in St. Petersburg, when Shama told me to wake up at 5 a.m. and then go for my prayer walk. Then when I went out, the light appeared. And we were discussing just now, it was the light of a cherubim. And the glory of God was following me, and then it attracted all the angels. So the light of God is power, is energy. And it has been invested in you. You have received it, believe it. And even when you are in your normal working days, when you go to office or at home, in the spiritual realm, you are shining. And last night, it was very prominent because why? You were into prayer. And you were fasting also. And that increases the intensity of our life. So I want to encourage all of us here to continue, press on, okay? The angels, they also receive that encouragement, the energy from our light that radiate out. They also receive the light of glory from Pergamos. And having prophesied to them, having, it was a very marvelous experience. There I was prophesying, the light of God was there, and the angels were all receiving, and after that they were worshiping. The way angels worship, very different. The impression is they are one. The unity, the flow, the the passion, the love, you know, is there. So something for us to take note. I would really love for you to dwell on that. Isaiah 60 verse 1. Okay. Sorry. Wait. There's a phone call. Wait, yeah. Hold on. Okay. Yeah. Why you disturb me? I said 10,000 lah. Not 5,000. Last week the pastor said ask for 5,000 because he fasts a lot. He doesn't eat much. Well, I eat a lot, one or four meals a day. 10,000, okay? 10,000, huh? Okay, never mind. Get Eddie to go. He eats 6 meals a day. He know what to do one. And tell Eddie, if he can negotiate to 15,000, I give him extra 10% cut. Okay? Okay. Yeah. I've been waiting the whole week to pull his leg with this joke. Now, I have a purpose for that demonstration because it is part of my sharing. Okay? don't be offended by that, okay? Just fun only. Okay. But now, last week, this set of prophecies that I prophesy has really been impacting my life in many ways. I haven't really managed to memorize more than 4 verses. Okay, the first 4 only, and they're all there 27. And the longest one was Micah chapter 4. Oh, ting kao kao. So someone was joking, say, hey, why don't you write the verses on your arm? So one chapter, Micah 4 to cover everything now. You know, so how about the other 26 verses? So pray for me lah. Especially my coming trip. Okay? My coming trip is it's going to complete my phase one. When, you know, in the end time, the Middle East area, the European, the Roman Empire, all those area is very crucial. So my next trip, I would complete. So I'm not sure how long I'll be away, maybe at least 4 weeks. I will find my way to enter Syria and Iraq, okay? Probably from Jordan. Then I'll go to Egypt and Saudi Arabia. And then another country, Ethiopia. All right. So I think there is that purpose why I should memorize the verses, because if I were to enter into like Iraq, I cannot open my Bible, you know. I have to go by memory, stretch out my hand and prophesy. So pray for me lah on that. Huh? Now, last week I shared on the first prophecy, Psalms 31, verse 23 and 24, talk about loving God. Oh, love the Lord, all you His saints. The Lord preserves the faithful and repays the proud doer. Be of good courage, and He will strengthen you, all those who hope in the Lord. Is it memory already? Not bad. Only the first one. Okay. So now, I feel that it is important for me to also talk about the last part of it. I cannot go through all the 27 prophecy, but it was the last prophecy when I prophesied. I was in the church of Laodicea, and I was stretching my hand towards north, south, east, west, and these few verses, you know, it is a very strong reminder for the Church of God to take note. And it is something I feel that you should know the implication of this verse. So let us all turn to Isaiah chapter 33, verse 10. The implication of praying for revival, we must know also that the judgment comes to the house of the Lord first. Revival is not all bless, 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 good, everything good, you know. But when revival comes, God say He will come like a refining fire. He will burn up the dross. So there is the implication of judgment when the revival comes. So this is something I want to seriously share with you to take note that, you know, as much as we all have been praying for revival, judgment will begin first with us, with your individual life. So Isaiah 30 verse 10 to 16. Now I will rise, says the Lord. Now I will be exalted. Now I will lift myself up. You shall conceive chaff. You shall bring forth stubble. Your breath as fire shall devour you. And the people shall be like the burnings of lime. Like thorns cut up, they shall be burned in the fire. Hear, you who are far off, what I have done. And you who are near, acknowledge my might. The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has seized the hypocrites. Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings? He who walks righteously and speaks uprightly. He who despises the gain of oppressions. Who gestures with his hand, refusing bribes. Who stops his ears from hearing of bloodshed and shuts his eyes from seeing evil. He will dwell on high. His place of defense will be the fortress of rocks. Bread will be given him. His water will be sure. When revival come, if you are the one who walk righteously and uprightly, you will dwell on high. Because if not, the judgment of the Lord is upon you. Let's pray. Father, we acknowledge, Lord, that you have been the one who has invaded, Lord, into our church. You have taken control, Lord. We have caught us unaware of all these things that has happened the last few months. But yet, Lord, you know our hearts, Lord, that we are obedient. We are submissive, Lord, to your act, your purpose. So, Lord, I pray, Lord, that your spirit would be the witness, would affirm the words that is going to be proclaimed today. That, Lord, your spirit will be the one that will strengthen us and to give us hope, Lord. That, Lord, you seek to refine us, to bring us into your fortress of rock, Lord. So, Lord, we want to pray that you will open our heart and mind to your word, that we will be prepared, Lord. Indeed, when you come, we thank you in Christ's name. Amen. You know, whenever I proclaim all those verses to all those places, because of the real-time event where angels are participating, I was always in a real-time assistant. So every time I say now, it felt like it was now. And indeed, what is a few years to God? The prophet would be there pronouncing now, but in a, you know, it's just in a blink of an eye, it was now. So I was always having that impressed on me that when I prophesy, it was now. Because one of the things we realize about the cube, the sixth dimension, is always the cause and effect. There is always a a communication line connecting the six planes. And that one is a light. That was the password, actually. Sharma gave me that password, that line. When I touch that, I enter into it. So, you know, the future is yet to come, but yet it is happening. In the cube dimension, the past has passed, but it is happening. So it is a very real time. And therefore, I have never doubted. I only doubted the first church of Ephesus. I was, first, I didn't know how to prophesy. Second, you know, I was so cold, miserably cold. And then third, you know, I mean, it was happening. I think all of us know, on the January when you all prayed for me, I was, my mindset, I was going there as a missionary. So when that happened, I was doubting. But after that, after the Church of Smyrna, I never doubted that it was the Lord leading me to prophesy and proclaiming, and that everything I prophesied was real time. It will come to pass, or it has come to pass. So that is a very real assistance for me. This is why, actually, it was also in the first trip and the second trip where Sharma always say, the last 2 days, 3 days, take a break. Don't come home straight, because I'll be lost. So it was, even in the last 3 days in Moscow, it was a debrief for me. It was in Moscow that I entered into the cube again, I dared to, because I was quite overwhelmed. So in my sleep, I was praising the Lord, worshiping, and then I said, Lord, okay, let me enter into it, but in my sleep. So in my sleep, I had nowhere to go, because it was in the spirit, not in the physical. And then I was able to understand more, and I was able to describe it so that I can tell Pastor about it. So now, there are also many other things that, if the more we're going to preach and share about it, the more you will imply on us. For example, Sharma is the angel of death. When he was in Moses' time, the plague, the tenth plague, when it was after the Israelites have put the blood of the lamb on the door, and then those Egyptians who did not do it, it was Sharma and his three generals who brought out the host of angels with their sword drawn. And they went throughout all the land, and that land was huge. Egypt was even as huge as this present Egypt. And the angels all went out and killed every firstborn. That is who Sharma is also. And that it is important for the three generals to be with us, because why? They are witnessing, because when the time comes for judgment, they will be the one who act on the Lord's word. And it is a very serious thing that I want to talk about today. That, you know, God will arise and he will judge. There is a threefold assertion of God's judgment here. You know, in verse 11, it says, you shall conceive chaff, you shall bring forth stubble, your breath aspire shall devour you. You know, it is something to note here. The prophet Isaiah used the example of conceiving, of pregnancy. And you know, the nations that would not repent, the people in this world who would not repent, whatever they scheme up, whatever they plan to do, it will be like a pregnancy that is empty. My wife went through four miscarriages, or three times was like that was a feeling of pregnancy, the vomiting, everything, but it was empty sack. And that is exactly how it's going to come. When the Lord arises, the day of judgment, many will find themselves, what they have conceived are just chaff that will burn up by themselves. And here in 11 and 12, it speaks about self-destruction that is self-induced. Destruction that is self-induced. You are going to act against God. Now, all these nations that I'm going to, the Lord, because it is proclaimed in the spiritual realm, the Lord will act on His words. This is why it's important that the nations that I've been instructed to go, I must go. Because why? Then the Lord will act on His word. So you will see my first phase, all these countries that I have been to, greater judgment will be upon them when the Lord comes. So this is something that we want to pray about it. I hope you remember when we come every time on our overnight prayer, continue to write the prophecy, because these are all going along the highway. Because the highway is going to be built based on prophecy, and God is going to act on those prophecy. When I was in Israel, I refused at first to pronounce judgment on Israel. I was brought up to Mount Olive, and the Holy Spirit gave me certain verses, and I was hesitant. I said, no, I want to come here and bless your people, bless Israel. But the Lord said, no, I will judge my people also. And I refused. And you know what happened? I was nearly blown off the mountain. I didn't tell my family. I refused. I was standing up there, and suddenly a strong gust of wind came. I nearly fell off, you know. I said, oh, yo. Chuat, you know. This is why the word chuat come now. I was so frightened, you know. And then Gabriel and Michael were there. You know. So I relented. I said, okay, I'll prophesy. This is something that is in the Word of God. When He rises, when God rises, when God exalts Himself, He cannot do but judge. Because His glory comes, He cannot allow evil to go scot-free. He must judge. Anyone, any nation, any people that is disobedient, evil, the judgment of God will come. And these people, they will see that their destruction is self-induced. This is why the Lord will allow all this spirit free hand right now to do. It is by free will, the people of God, even people in Singapore, by free will, we will continue to do evil. God allows it, because why? Then when His judgment comes, He is justified. He will remove. He will judge. He will destroy. And I believe this is why Shama and the three generals are with me all the time. Because they will be the one who act on that judgment. This is why when I go to places, I meet up with angels, because they will be also doing the act of God. The archangel that I saw in Russia is as powerful as Shama. And we talk about the two evil spirits that will be released soon. Shama brought me near to them in the spirit. They are being locked up in, you know, I think in Siberia or some part, when the plane was flying over, I think maybe even 3/4 of Russia are all snow and ice, you know. Those spirits are being locked up there. So I was brought in spirit near them. And even going near them, I could feel their hatred, their thoughts of evil. And I have never seen Sharma displaying his glory, the three generals, the archangels, and the other angels. I felt like I was a dwarf, you know, because their glory were manifested, and Sharma was like twice his height. And the generals were all in full glory. You see, it was to display to the two spirits, see? You will be released, but you are limited. When the time comes, they'll be the one who will chain them up again. And this is something here when God said, I will arise, I will be exalted, I will lift myself up. He speaks of the totality of God's judgment. Nothing, no evil will slip through. Every evil act will be dealt with. So this is, that's why I felt, you know, the whole, all the prophecy that I have pronounced, this last one is a very sober, serious, that all of us must take note. Let's continue to read verse 13. It says here, hear, you who are far off, what I have done. And you who are near, acknowledge my might. The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has seized the hypocrites. Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings? He who walks righteously and speaks uprightly. He who despises the gain of oppressions. He who gestures with his hands, refusing bribes. Who stops his ears from hearing of bloodshed and shuts his eyes from seeing evil. He will dwell on high. His place of defense will be the fortress of rocks. Bread will be given him. His water will be sure. Hear, you who are far off, what I have done. As a prophet of God that has been sent to all these places, I have declared to the nation in the spirit realm what God has done. I have declared to them the victory of God, the triumph of God. Submit to them. But because of self-will, many will not submit. But I have to declare that, that God is victorious. In Pergamos, the victory I saw was so tremendous. And the light of God shined out. But yet, heart will still be hardened. God, this is a message to the whole world. This is why after my phase one, there are many other nations that I will have to go to. In one vision in Russia, I saw four beasts. The first beast, I was praying towards China, Japan, and Korea. There was a stretch of Gulf along that stretch where even China was nearly about only 40 kilometers away across the sea. So the Gulf, and then towards the same direction, Japan and then Korea. And then I had this vision. First, I saw an animal which is a cross between a raccoon and a monkey. The first half of the body is raccoon, you know, you see the cute, cute eye, you know. Then behind is the monkey, the tail and all those. A tortoise appear, and they were side by side each other, and then suddenly the two claws of the phoenix came and caught hold of these two animals, and the phoenix appeared, you know, it came and it flew down and it caught hold of these two. Then a tiger came from behind and the phoenix and put a paw on the tail of the phoenix. And as I continue to look at it, I saw that the cross, the animal cross between raccoon and monkey, the tail caught fire. And burn, then, you know, it was trying to run away, but it was being constrained by the claw of the phoenix. And it was trying to squeeze. And then it burned its buttock also. The fire spread. Okay. And then at the same time, I saw the tortoise head came out, and then suddenly a light cut off his head. And then the light came again and cut off the tortoise into two. Now, when this burning and cutting happened, it injured the phoenix. So it wanted to fly off, release, but it couldn't because the tail was being held down by the tiger. And when all this happened, I saw arrows shooting from heaven coming down and injuring every beast. So I went to the manager of the interpretation department. I say, help me lah. I see, but interpretation pangmang wala. So he said, okay, look at the strongest, interpret from the strongest animal, tiger. And because I was praying toward these three countries, China is the strongest country right now. So the tiger represent the China. Then the phoenix would represent Japan. And then the raccoon, monkey, animal, South Korea, and then North Korea. And in the brief, he was saying, it was in history, it was Japan that came conquered Korea also. Okay? But the phoenix, Japan is being restrained by China because China is more powerful. The phoenix is an animal that always die and rise. Okay? But it will always be restrained. So if you look at the East, the archangel, when I met him first time, he called himself the Prince of the East. So he has been placed in that part to control the powers of the East. This is why they will never, although no matter how powerful China is, it will never become a world power because the end time prophecy is going to happen in Middle East. Russia, the European countries, the Middle East countries. This is why my main part of my travel is to these places. Russia, I went there so that I can prophesy and restrain their power also. So now then I asked something, say, hey, where did the arrow come from? From the heaven, he said, you shot the arrow. I said, huh? Oh, yeah. So I remember in the seven churches, Shama brought me, I was in Philadelphia, he brought me back as Jebe. The bay was with a wing, and I went there and I prophesied, and then I shot the arrow north, south, east, west. In the north, I shot, and then Shama gave me a quiver of arrows. I said, shoot as many. And I'm glad I shot all. So I said, oh, this arrow. Then I was shooting a beast in the vision. I was shooting a beast and I wounded two. A lot of them died, but I wounded two. So in this vision, I wounded the tiger and the phoenix also. So if we were to, I think it will be very interesting once I come back from my third trip, when we do a complete debrief, we'll see everything connecting. All right? So, and this is something we must acknowledge God's mind. In verse 13, he says here, hear you who are afar off what I have done, and you who are near, acknowledge my might. Don't wait. I know there are certain mysteries that will not be given to us. They are in the cube, although what Esther say, this cube like time machine, I can go into the future. I mean, I can tap into that, but there will be some mystery that will be held off, will not be revealed. And I believe the exact timing will not be revealed, but we have an idea, because why Shama gave me a clue. Because I've been asking, when will the two spirits be released? When will the revival start and all those things? And Shama said, look at your both timeline. He is the pilot, I'm the navigator. So his timeline is going to end in 2016. A new decade will start. This year, I start my timeline. So from his new decade, will be 2016. And from 2016 to 2025, our timeline are in sync. And that period, many things will happen. So there are glimpses, but I believe the Lord is withholding. And anyway, we are very cautious. We do not want to misuse that cube thing. So as a spirit lead, okay. Even like last night, the Lord knows. Yesterday, whole day, I've been praying for my churches in Cambodia. Okay? And by the way, one thing my wife and I were saying, hey, it was only 6 months ago that we were called missionaries, no? Now so prophet liao leh. So it's a very different thing. But because the last 2 months, the pastor in charge of the churches there has not been giving me report. And I mean, I've been troubled, you know. I don't want to come and say, hey, where's my report, you know, but so I've been quite troubled. So yesterday I was praying, and then last night the cube, the spirit allowed me to tap into it, and I went over there to take a look, and I saw what's happening. So I believe this cube thing, you know, we can seek, but it is the controller. The Holy Spirit is a controller. He will dictate what to do, what to see. Okay. So, the verse here is very serious. We must acknowledge the might of God. Now, if you do not know what kind of might we are talking about, then look at the Noah's day. It is no coincidence that I've been given the vision about Noah and how the flood came and killed all mankind. It's no coincidence when I saw Shama sending one of the angels. Two of them went over, and they were the one who brought destruction to Sodom and Gomorrah. It was no coincidence in the Paroma vision. I saw Shama with sword drawn confronting Balaam. And then there was a God was merciful. Shama made the donkey talk to Balaam. So this is the might of God that I'm talking about, where God, he's going to come in and, you know, judge on all of us. Now let's read verse 14 again. It is something that we must take note. The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has seized the hypocrites. Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings? In this context, here is talking about Zion, but in the bigger context, we are talking about church. And it is inconceivable, but it is true, it is happening, that there are sinners in our churches. We cannot deny that. That there are people who are sinning, continue to sin, but yet come every Sunday as though nothing has happened. This is something that we must comprehend. God will only allow you to continue because why? The day of judgment will come. This is why it is the task of everyone us to approach our brother and sister, those you whom you know who are sinning, correct them. Correct them. Warn them. The time when God comes, the sinners in the churches will tremble with fear. I cannot reinforce this with you. While we are waiting, this is why God is merciful. We may say, oh, why wait so long? We may have to wait for a few more years. But it is because God is merciful. God is giving us chances to repent of our sin. Because why? On the day of judgment, the devouring fire of God will come. Hebrews 12:29 says, God is a consuming fire. It is the same fire I witnessed when the fire came when Elijah challenged the priest of Baal at Mount Carmel. The fire came, zoom! Everything, even the wet sacrifices, everything was consumed up. Nothing is left. This is what will come on the day when God arises, when God exalts himself. His fire will consume the sinners in our churches. I wish that there is that fear to recognize this truth, to really examine ourselves. Those of us who need to repent, do it soon. Do it soon. We had a former friend from my previous church who came to have fellowship with us, and the wife was sharing, and only the wife came, sharing, you know, how the church is, you know, not growing, everything, and no life. The sermon is very boring, no life. And yet they don't, you know, they don't want to do anything about it. Only the wife, the husband are not doing anything. I told her, I said, warn him. Because why? You will die. If you don't act on that, you will die. You know, in Mark chapter 9, there is a story of Jesus healing the man's a son of a man who was possessed by a spirit, the dumb and deaf spirit. And then finally the man say, I believe, help my unbelief. We must take action. If right now in your life there is unbelief, don't leave it there. It will grow. It will be like the leprous disease. You will grow. You will increase in your life. You must do something about it. This is why we must be like the man who cried, Lord, there are things I believe, but there are things I cannot believe. I cannot. I have no way to believe. Help me with this unbelief. We must cry out to the Lord, because on the day of judgment, there is no prophetic book where you will be given a prophecy that, oh, yeah, okay, I have confessed. No. This revival is going to be sweeping the whole world at the same time. And the judgment of God is going to sweep across at the same time. So, let's be warned. This is why I feel that this is something I need to tell you. The prophecies of God is not all about his victory. Yes, but there is the second part about his victory. His glory will come with judgment. This is why he will allow the demons free hand for a certain time to create havoc, and it is on your own self-will whether to stay clean or to compromise. But the time will come when God will judge. This is why just now I added up that sin about taking bribes. It is something that you have to watch us. Okay, especially if we cannot deny this gift that the Lord has given us in our midst is a very powerful gift. Okay, so I have to be careful on that. This is why my first rule will be this. This one will be a second rule. Remember, I told you about first rule. Don't say, "Hey, where's Shama?" What is Shama doing? Don't ask me that, because I'm not allowed to say. Okay? So this second rule here is, "Hey, what do you see in the cube?" All these things. Don't tell me. Don't ask me. Whatever I see, I'll talk to the manager of the interpretation department first. Okay, I'll go through him first. Okay, Shama, make it very clear. He's the pilot, I'm the navigator. So the tool that has been given to me is like, make me the navigator. I will see things, you know, the Lord will reveal certain things and I'll tell the pilot, hey, tauge up there want us to do this, do that. Like, okay, you are the pilot. You chart. You tell us how. So this is how we're going to work. Okay? So the cube thing, anyway, I'm still learning. Yesterday, first time, after that, second time, I was a bit, don't know how to, you know, suddenly lost my password, don't know how to enter. So I had to get out and pray in tongue again for a while, then I went in. It's something new, lah. Okay. But here, it's not all negative. Let's read verse 15 again. He who walks righteously and speaks uprightly, he who despises the gain of oppressions, who gestures with his hands, refusing bribes, who stops his ears from hearing bloodshed and shuts his eyes from seeing evil. If you are like this, if you determined to be such a person, if you are already in progress to be such a person, then verse 16, the Lord promises, when his judgment come, you will dwell on high. Your place of defense will be the fortress of rocks. Bread will be given you. You'll be provided. Water will be sure. You'll be safe. And the word safe is going to be something of high, a commodity of high value when the time comes. Really. When the judgment of God comes, to be saved is something that is very precious. I feel very safe when I travel. Because why? I got Sharma and the three generals. Wherever I go, even when I go jogging, two of them will follow me. Usually, when it's certain period, Sharma will go somewhere. So the three generals stay with me. So when I go jogging, the two follow. One will stay in my hotel. Got my things in the hotel. I mean, some of the places I go, I can't trust the people. So it is a good feeling to be safe. And I think also the other part, they want to make sure safeguard me, because it might take another long time, many years to get a thing like me to do the work. Right? So it is dual. I feel safe. They also want to safeguard me. Alright. So, but of course, that doesn't mean we take for granted. So when I go to places, especially when I go for many trips, Iraq and Syria, I found the border crossing, and I'm going to kakak. Alright. So now I just want to close with this word. The now is going to come like this, suddenly. Now! And then he will arise. And it happens all. He will exalt himself. It's going to be the instantaneous. There is no way. I am not ready. No. The fire of God will come and devour. Your destruction will be self-induced. So if the wicked are walking wickedly right now, and they prosper, don't be jealous. Their destruction is self-induced. They are digging, in the sense that they are digging their own grave. If they refuse to repent, the judgment of God will come and you sweep up. Okay, last night, one of the visions the Lord gave me was the controlling spirit of Singapore. Okay, I had yet to discuss with Pastor. So, this is, there is a one big spirit controlling Singapore, evil spirit, okay? So, and he has free play with us. So, and imagine when the two spirits are released, it's going to be havoc in this world. One of the things I saw when the spirit of seduction released, there'll be increase of male prostitutes in this world. Now we all are uncomfortable with the gay and all these things. But I tell you, they are going to have greater foothold in the decisions of nations. And when the spirit of seduction is released, it is a flood of seduction. Male prostitution will increase. So this is something we must, you know, this is why continue to pray in our overnight prayer. Pray against all this. Pray for people to repent. And pray to limit all this power. They will have their free prey, but we pray that God. So whatever prophecy you give, God gives you, write it down. Because some of this prophecy is to limit their power, to limit their territory. So Singapore is not exempted. We must pray. Even pray that, you know, wherever you live, that the Lord will limit your surrounding, your neighborhood. All these things we need to press on because we need to pray. Come, let's pray. Father, we want to acknowledge, Lord, your power. We want to humble ourselves before you, Lord, and ask, Lord, that you search us, Lord. Like David says, see if there be any wicked ways in us, Lord. In our thoughts, even if we are beginning to plan something wicked for Monday when we go to work against a colleague, I pray, Lord, that you forgive us. Surely, Lord, truly, Lord, we pray. Search us, Lord. See if there's any wickedness in us. Cleanse us, Lord. Make us pure. That, Lord, we would be that person who walks righteously. That we are that person who speaks uprightly. Who despise the gain of oppressions. And who will refuse bribes. So, Lord, we ask, have mercy on us, but yet, Lord, we trust in you. Again, I want to say, love the Lord first. Those of us who do not love the Lord, you will surely fear the judgment of God. But if you love the Lord will preserve. Psalms 31, 23 and 24, the Lord will preserve. The Lord will repay the proud doer, but the Lord, if you are faithful, if you are loving the Lord, he will preserve. So let this hope increase in us as we love the Lord. And on the day when God rises us up, we will stand on the rock, fortress of rocks, and our footing will be sure. We want to sing your praises, Lord, in our midst, Lord, that thou art great, that thou deserve all the honor and glory from our lips, from our thoughts. You deserve, Lord, all our praises. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
Afterwards, we're going to pray for each one of us, and I believe that we flow with the theme of holiness unto the Lord. And the purpose of the Lord judging and bringing forth is so that we are not finally judged when we are facing the throne of God. And the purpose of all this judgment is so that God can reveal his glory. And he raised up to a higher standard of holiness. And so let's look at some scriptures just before we do some ministry. In the book of 1 Corinthians, all the things that Pastor David has been speaking about, you find, is within all these scriptures that God has made. In chapter 3, in reference to the Church of Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And Paul says in verse 11, 12, 13 and 14 onwards, "For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Now if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear. For the day, that is the day of judgment, will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work, of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet as though through fire." And this is in the context in which Paul is telling the Corinthian church, in the context of chapter 3, verse 1, he says, "Be spiritual people, not carnal people." And then he tells them that every one of us have to give account to God, even in the last days, at the judgment seat. And the purpose of judgment is to benefit us. And mind you, the role of a prophet, even to examine what the role of the prophet is many times to remind us of these things. And I believe that the ministry of a prophet is typified in Jeremiah chapter 1. I read to you the scriptures too. When God called Jeremiah to be a prophet, he says to Jeremiah, after saying how he has sanctified him to be a prophet of the Lord, he says here in verse 9 and 10, Jeremiah chapter 1, "Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day set you over the nations and over the kingdoms, to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant." Now notice, you cannot build and plant until you root out, you pull down, you destroy, you throw down. When you buy an old building or old house, and you need to build a new one, you can't just build on it. You might have to knock down what needs to be knocked down, remove what needs to be removed, and some of the old wiring and old areas that cannot be used anymore, the piping, have to be removed, and you put in new ones. And that's the role of a prophet, and to always speak of these things. And many times, overall, the message will always be good, positive. But many times there will be an aspect of it that needs to remind us that these are the things we need to remove. These are the things that we need to clear from our lives in order not to destroy us, in order that we can receive what God wants us to receive. And 2 Corinthians, we look at 2 Corinthians. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Again, to Christians, and there are various types of judgment. We cover it in volume 14, Foundational Truth. There's a judgment of nations and the Great White Throne judgment, which is right at the end. And there are various judgments. But to Christians, there is also a judgment seat of Christ in chapter 5, verse 9 and 11. And this talks about Christians, not non-Christians. And therefore, we make it our aim, Paul says, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to Him. So we must make it our aim to be pleasing to God. In verse 10, "For we must all appear." So I have heard at one time some people discuss with me, many years ago before I came to Singapore, the grace message has been preached in Singapore. They try to eliminate judgment completely. And and the people brought me some of the things. So we discussed the doctrine. I say, you cannot remove it. It's a Bible verse. And so sometimes instead of removing, they try to reinterpret it in a different way. But whichever way you interpret it, you cannot escape 1 Corinthians 3 and 2 Corinthians 5. That we have to give an account for what we do on this earth. And it says here in verse 10, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ." We must all appear. And it's not just to frighten us. In 1 Corinthians 3, you see that generally people who come to know the Lord are saved. But 1 Corinthians 3, the passage I read earlier, it has nothing to do with salvation. Of course, some might be lost if they really turn away from Christ, according to Hebrews 6 and Hebrews 10. There's a possibility. But I'm sure there's a minority. But it's not talking about salvation alone. See, the judgment is not about salvation. Judgment is about God wanting to bless us. God wants to reward us. Now that we've come to know Christ, He's concerned that you could live your whole life on earth and then all you get is you scrap through by the skin of your teeth, like 1 Corinthians 3. You're saved, but everything else in your life is burned. All your whole life was wasted. You might as well be born a baby and die a baby. All your adult life and all your elderly life, all wasted because it was not living God. And so, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it says here, we must all appear, and there's a purpose for it, that we might receive the things done in the body. That each may receive the things done in the body according to what has been done, he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade man, but we are well known to God, and I also trust are well known in your conscience. And so with that in mind, we realize that God's purpose for us is to bring us into holiness. A level of holiness by which we can know the Lord, we can worship the Lord. And why is that so? Why is all this judgment and these warnings important? Well, look at the book of Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. It says here in verse 14, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one can see the Lord. And you know why the Lord is speaking about all this, living a life that is holy unto Him, removing all those dross and all those sin and all those things that doesn't please Him out of our life? It is so that He can reveal Himself. He wants to bring us to the level of holiness that He can show Himself to us, show His glory to us. And much as we all desire the glory of God, we all cry, more God, more of your presence. And when God's presence comes, everything else that comes with it will come with it. And the blessings, the spiritual blessings, natural blessings, soul blessings, all the various blessings will come with God's presence. But for God's blessings to come, in His holiness. And for holiness to be in our lives, there is a free will that we have, a free choice that we have, and that we need to willingly allow the holiness of God to transform our lives. That's the picture within the church. There's another picture outside the church. And in the picture outside the church, one of the things I asked Pastor David is, the two angels that were bound in the area of ice and snow in Russia, on the eastern side. When were they bound? If they were bound a few hundred years ago, then I could trace their work historically, all the evil they have done, and after they were bound, what was the difference? And but it says that they were bound since the day of Enoch, since the day of Noah. In other words, from the time of Noah, they were bound. That means these evil spirits were involved in polluting the earth, destroying the entire earth and making it such that God has to destroy the whole earth and only letting 8 souls live through. Which brings us to this fact that we have not seen what evil they could do. We thought we have seen evil in the First World War, Second World War. We thought we have seen evil in some things that dictators did all over the world. And we thought we have seen evil by evil people in recorded history. But this is unrecorded history. No one knows what evil was like in the time of Noah. We only had a glimpse of that. And that tells us that the evil that will be released on the earth during the time when these two fallen angels are released is going to be beyond our imagination. It's beyond what we have seen of evil in the Second World War. Beyond what we've seen of evil in a time of recorded history over the past 2,000 years or so. It's beyond us. And because the world is going to be more evil, the world is going to be unimaginably evil and wicked, the only possibility of standing immune from all those things is a higher standard of holiness. And the Bible says when the enemy comes in like a flood, Isaiah 57, the Lord will raise a standard against him. Who are the standard? We are the standard. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit whom God filled with the glory of God to stand against the evil. That's the blessing that God has on our life. And that's why God requires more holiness in our life to face the greater temptation, things to come. If right now, whatever temptations are, you cannot stand, you think you can stand the greater temptation, you'll be just sucked in immediately, like a tiny ant into a whirlpool. That's why God is calling His church to raise up a standard of holiness, to walk with God, so that this standard of holiness will preserve us, will, number one, reward us for living with God, and preserve us in the times that are still to come. Such evil as we have never seen in human recorded history. And that's the urgent cry of the prophet that we need to heed. And lastly, when we have that message, okay, we need to be holy, we need to be this, we need to be that, the first thing all of us do, many times as human, we run and we try with our own effort. We try with our ways to try to make ourselves better people, and you will flop and fail again. Because the answer, again, is not so much how we can transform ourselves. And we bring you back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. It is more how much God can change you, and how much we allow God to change us, not how much we change ourselves. And when we hear that message, we need to also understand, one of the songs that Lionel just composed yesterday, and he sang a little bit of it, but he didn't sing the second part. On the first part, he talked about, I want to be holy, I want the blood of Jesus. And that's the normal cry of most people when you hear that. I want to be holy. I want to be holy. But the way to be holy is to realize you can never make yourself holy. No matter how you try. Men and women and nations have been trying for historical periods, and they never succeeded. The only way you and I can be holy is allow the light of God in you to make you holy. To put yourself in the presence of God and have a willing and open heart and says, I am willing, transform me. And to keep staying in the presence of God and letting Him change you. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, you would have it by now, in verse 18. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of God. And that's why when you talk about righteousness and holiness, the Lord uses phrases like the fruit of holiness, not the works of holiness, or the fruit of righteousness, not the works of righteousness. Because righteousness is not a work. Righteousness is a fruit. What's the difference between a fruit and work? A work is something I do. A fruit is something He grows inside me. I'm just a tree. I just keep taking nutrition, open to the sun that shines, the sun of our of righteousness, and I grow and produce it. And that's where as the call to righteousness, the call to holiness goes, we're not asking, okay, everyone try harder. Everyone, you know, make another whole 10 commandments. Make your 10 commandments, 100 commandments. You will die somewhere in number 11. The key is come to Jesus. The key is come and spend more time with Him. The key is come and allow Him to change your life by His glory. And it will slowly change. And this is why it takes time. It will slowly change your appetites. So that the things you love to taste, you no longer love. And instead, you love to taste the things of God. And it will slowly change your thought life. The things you like to think about, you don't like anymore. You like to think about the things of God. And the things you desire, like you really attract you before, suddenly it doesn't attract you anymore. The things of God become more attractive to you. And that takes time as it grows within you to expose ourselves to the glory of God. To allow at the beginning, as Pastor David was sharing, he's talking about the light of God. How is this light of God? And this is the light of God. When he says we behold the glory, glory is the light of God. And when you look at the light of God transforms you and make you the same light. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, it could be a mathematical equation. What you see is what you become. As you see, so have you become. So the whole process is looking into the light, understanding in the light, understand the anointing that you have received, the light that shined from Pergamos, the anointing that came back and is imparted into your life, the light that is given into you. As you sit down and you meditate on this light, you will go away different. As you sit down and you confess a word, it makes you different. Because the word contains light. And it's this light that you increase in your life. And as this light increase, suddenly those things drop off from you. And if I were to say, how do you make yourself clean? You need something to make you clean. All of us, when you want to clean yourself, you need water, you need soap. Water is good, but nowadays we also use soap. Why water is not enough? Why don't we just go and bathe just with water? Now you need clean water too. Because water sometimes cannot remove certain dirt that is clinging to you. That is all base. So you need soap, which has an alkali factor. It removes a lot of the things that stick to you. And so you need soap and water. Even in a natural, we cannot clean ourselves. You need some third element to clean you. Water, soap. And you cannot just, you know, hang your old clothes up and then after a while wear it again. It will get worse and worse. And you don't just, when you clean yourself, you don't expose yourself to the wind. Let the fan blow on you. No. You need something to contact you, to clean you. We cannot clean ourselves. The water represents the word. The water represents the blood of Jesus. Water represents cleansing. And so we need to come to God and let His blood, His word cleanse us. And all of it is in His light. It is His light that comes into our life and changes us, transforms us. And as we close, and we're going to pray for you as you say, Lord, but there must be a free will. You see, God cannot make you come. You can pull a horse to the water, but cannot make the horse drink. Horse say, I don't want to drink, means don't want to drink. And I don't know how each one of you in your olden days, in your life, whether you love water or don't love water. I have a dog, he hates water. He loves snow, but hates water. Long ago, a dog already passed away. And every time it comes to bathing the dog, he knows it. And he runs, because he's a free-range dog, right? Free-range chicken, free-range dog. He runs all over. He goes inside the house freely. Not tied down at all, because he knows his territory. But comes to bathing, you could see, he runs to my neighbor and hides, the neighbor's place. And then you have to wait a while until he came, and quickly tie him down. And then I put him, you know, put the water on him, and then and all those things. So sometimes we are not willing. And there need to be a free will. We are willing to come to God. We are willing to transform, to change. You see, if I ask every one of you right now, I say, do you feel the need for more prayer? Most Christians will say yes. You go outside to today is Saturday, where some of the mega churches are on. You go to a mega church on Saturday and Sunday. You ask the 30,000 people and says, how many of you feel that you should have prayed more? I tell you, 99% will raise up their hand. How many of you feel that you should take a closer look at God? 99% will put up their hand. How many of you feel that you need to know God more? They will all put up their hands. But when it comes to actually spending the time to do it, very few do it. They spend time on TV, movies, and everything else except. So the problem is not that we don't have an avenue. The problem is we just did not make a decision to take the time to do that. And that's why in the church, we don't care about all these things. We say, okay, we provide you the facilities. You know, pray, we had a group of people who pray on and on. You know, fast, a whole group of people fast. And in time to come, more and more people will be hungry for God. And that's why Jesus said, it's in the end our decision to take the time. So again, we say, we cannot change ourselves. God changes us. But how many want to go keep close to God to change you? We are like my dog, you know. And God says, bath time, we all run. And all our fur and all that is dirty. And in the end, sometimes, and then God has to wait. And then he has to wait until we are hungry. Feeding time. You got to eat. Right? And so you got to somehow, and you come near, and then God assigned the prophet, tie you down. Yeah, chain you down. Say, okay, now's the time to bathe you. And so we are drawn back to God. And the prophet pronounces, the prophet say, watch out there. You know, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. God's judgment is coming. And you also, we all kia kia. And then all come back to God. You know? So, you know, from kias, here, it always disturb your kiasu, right? So from kiasu, prophet come become kia kia. And then you come near to God. And then it keeps you there. At least in the fear of God. And then as you're taught and you're brought in the presence of God, sufficient time is spent with God. And somehow you're kept in the presence of God. And the presence of God like water cleansing you. Like the tap cleansing you. And then God puts a few other things there. You know, soap and water. Shoo, 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 and then all your fur clean. And then during the process, you don't like it. But after the process, you feel good. The thing is to keep you there long enough. If any of you got pets or anything, of course some pets love water and then they just love it. Why? Those are, you know, redeemed pets. So their appetites have changed. Things have changed in their lives. So they learn to love the right things. And so in the same way, we need to be drawn and kept in the light of God. Let the light of God change you. Because that light of God that comes from Pergamos, the light of God that is shining, if you expose to it for some time, it will change you. You didn't change yourself. It changes you. And as you keep meditating on what you have received. And so in closing, I want to talk about the power of this light. Just throw you those points without the teaching on them. And the light of God is the creative force behind the universe. And it continues to create in your life. The Gospel of John chapter 1. All the avenues of this light. Any new thing that is to be created, any new forces or gifting that is to be created, it needs this light. In John chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. We know that when we accept Christ, we receive eternal life. But this eternal life is the life of God. It says in John chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. In him was life, and the life was the light of man. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. This is not natural sunlight. This is talking about the spiritual light of God. When God created the whole planet and the universe in Genesis chapter 1, the first words that were said, everything was dark, and it says, God say, let there be light. And there's a light that goes forth, and that light that goes forth was not sunlight. That was the light, creative light that God sent that can create anything else in the universe. Because if you read carefully, the sun, the moon, and all that came later. And so it was a different type of light. It was a spiritual light. The sun's light and everything are only natural pictures or allegories of what God's light is. So that light goes forth, and the light that is shining from Pergamos, the light that comes from Jesus Christ, is a life-giving light. Like a plant, if you were willing to stay long enough, then you will have that light. And we have a childcare in Sydney, and in the childcare, it's all indoors, air-conditioned, so there's no windows on the inside. And but because of the requirement, my wife had to put plants indoor. And then normally you could maintain the plants differently. You could either lease the plants and the people will bring the change the plants all the time. Or if you own the plants, you got to take the plants out and you got to put them out, especially in the daytime, and then make sure they got sufficient sunlight. Otherwise, the plants will die. And then although it's fluorescent light, it doesn't have all the wave bands that the plant needs. So the plants you can see when you first buy it, wow, nice. Over a few months become yellowish, and in fact some of them almost dying. So I told my wife, I said, hey, something you need to be done. Is there any light there on Saturday or Sunday? He said, unless the church is there, it's all in darkness. Imagine the plants are in darkness, so no light. Of course the plants will die. And thankfully we have a design that they discovered that plants don't actually need white light. Plants need a blue light and red light. And so when you combine those diets, like plants can exist even in that. So we had it. You say, wow, you got all these things. Yeah, yeah. We love to experiment. And I had all those things. And I used to test it. Sometimes a church member would say, can you hold the light for 1 hour to see what the side effect is on your life? And they did. We hold. And they say, how do you feel? So we had those experiments. So I gave it all to my wife and say, okay, put it on the weekend. Let the plants be a bit healthier. The plant don't need to do anything. All the plant need to do is just be in the light. Just be in the light. And that's the first thing. That light has life. The reason you got no power over sin is because you don't have enough life. If you have more life, you have more power over sin. And so let that life increase in your life. Number two, I only got three small points, and so don't worry how long it's going to go. And Malachi chapter 3, in Malachi chapter 3, which is just before Matthew, the last book of the Old Testament, and chapter 4, rather, Malachi chapter 4, it says there in verse 2, but to you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings, and you shall go out and grow fat like stall fat cows. Now, that one fat is a fat in a good way. But you see, the Son of Righteousness, what does the Son give? Light. Shall arise with healing in his wings. Good health, spiritual health comes from life. And it is your spirit, according to the book of James chapter 3, there's a little statement there that we won't turn to. It says that the body without the spirit is dead. So it's your spirit that sustains your body right now. And in the book of Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27, it says that the candle of man is the lamp of the Lord. Or the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord. In other words, your spirit is the light. And that light sustains your physical body. Number two, if you want healing, you want to be whole, you want to be never sick at all, let your spiritual life be strong. And when that spiritual life is strong in you, sickness doesn't come easily. Somehow your body has a greater immunity, naturally. And behind it is not just biology. Behind it sometimes is this spiritual life that sustains. And there's a particular lady, and I use her testimony, even though she was not a Christian. Her name is Anita Marioni or something like that. And She is not a believer, not a Christian. She was given 3 to 6 months to live. And this is a real medical tested case. And that's why I always use cases that have been documented. They have all the documentation, hospital things and all those things. And it's documented that all the cancer has spread. She's given 3 to 6 months to live. I think about only 3 months. And then as she sought whatever means to help in her own way, one day, I believe the mercy of God, she was given a glimpse of her spirit man. And for some reason, her spirit man was still reasonably strong. And when she saw her, she came out of the body. She nearly died and came out of the body. And then she saw her spirit man was shiny. And when she saw, wow, how powerful was the spirit man. And then she went back into the body. She went back with a new revelation that there is strength in her spirit. And she's not even a believer yet. She's probably like Cornelius extent. And when she went back into her body, the one thought that remained in her mind was, her spirit man is very strong. Not like the physical body was just dying. And even as she thought about that, and it just struck her, the thought about her shininess of a spirit man, she started getting well. All the cancer cells started dying. And she was fully healed and cured. And because she was a Singaporean and she lives in Hong Kong, her testimony has been going around. It's on the internet. And I can send it to you if you want. I'll send to Eddie. And that just to see an unbeliever who is a reasonably good person like Cornelius, the spirit man. How much more when you got the Son of Righteousness riding in you? So you got a test case, and the only reason she got healed is not this account or that account or anything. She just had a glimpse of a spirit man. How much more if we have a glimpse of what our spirits are like, and you hold the image in you, it will produce healing, wholeness, and health. And last point, Ephesians chapter 1. We know in this modern world, it is more a world of brain versus brawn, different from societies of thousands of years ago, where being pugilistic and skillful with your sword fighting skills and physical prowess will help you to be a powerful person in society. In our society, you see sometimes an ordinary skinny little fella and could be a geek or some person, but because of their ideas and brain, they become the most powerful people on earth. And so our society is a society of knowledge and ideas. And knowledge, in a sense, is power. Wisdom, of course, is greater. And through knowledge and wisdom and power, you become better than other people if your knowledge and wisdom is more accurate than theirs. And we see even in our modern society, China was a very powerful country way back in historical days. A lot of inventions came up from China. But at some point, those inventions were not continued. While in the Western country, they invented guns and they, with this gunpowder that was founded in China. That is China that founded gunpowder, but they didn't turn it into a metal gun. And it was a technology of the Western nations. And then they began to use it for many things. By the time Western nations were confronting Asian nations, just about 100, 200 years ago, no matter how powerful your kung fu is, you can just take a small little kid or 16-year-old and you go, and you go, and that's it. I remember there was one particular movie when this guy was kung fu with all his sword skill and he made all this nice, beautiful movement. And then the Western guy just said, oh, wow. And then he died because the bullet was more powerful and all those things. There's such a vast difference in technology that China at first, and then China became sort of almost a tributary nation, dominated by Western countries, until nations like Japan, and then now China, began to take the knowledge of the West. Same thing you can produce, we start producing. The same things you can mass produce, we produce. So slowly, they began to grow in the technology area, and it becomes a competitor today. Knowledge, wisdom, is power in our time. And the same way, in your businesses, in a society, knowledge, wisdom, and power. Everybody go through university and come out. Universities graduate hundreds of thousands of accountants all over the world, graduate hundreds of lawyers all over the world, hundreds of scientists all over the world. What will be the difference between them? The one who have an extra edge. Could be through discipline, but many times through knowledge. And they would have an edge above all the others. And they invent a product, created something, and that's the leading edge. And the Holy Spirit can give you the wisdom. That third area is the light of wisdom. Ephesians chapter 1 says there in verse 17 and 18, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of His calling, what are the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints, what is the exceeding greatness of His power towards us who believe. So you notice, the wisdom of knowledge would come into us, that the eyes of understanding be enlightened. The Greek word enlightened means to be flooded with light. So when we are flooded with the light of God, your knowledge and your wisdom, your capacity to invent, your capacity to know things, your capacity to have a leading edge, to understand things. And this doesn't just include Bible knowledge. Remember that when God gave to Daniel and his friends wisdom, they could do everything the non-Christians do of the Babylonian Empire, and they were found to be 10 times smarter and wiser than all of them. So that wisdom that God gave could handle even secular knowledge, and not just godly and spiritual knowledge. And Daniel and his three friends were found to be 10 times smarter, wiser than all the wise men. And the test that they were put through was very thorough, because their schooling took many years. They had to learn the schooling of the Chaldeans and all their literature and all those things. No escape. Every young man went through that. And when they were tested, you think their test was asking about Yahweh God or the Israelite religion? No. Nothing religious in their test. Every test that they went through was a secular test, and they came 10 times wiser, 10 times smarter. That's how much the wisdom of God can come into your life. And you look at it today, all the top billionaire companies today were created with somebody's ideas. And so we realize that this is a society of wisdom and knowledge. If you want to advance in wisdom and knowledge, let the light of God come into your life. And so on overall again, where have we taken us? We have received the message of the prophet. Tells us that there is a judgment, and God is judging. And He needs to prophesy judgment many times in order for the holiness of God to come forth. And the call is unto us that judgment begins in the house of God. And that as we realize where the judgment is, we need to be willing to be shaken until we are willing to come to God. And the church is coming to the state where just being an ordinary Christian and getting by is not enough. When these demon forces are released, some of these weak Christians are the first that are going to fall. That's why judgment has to begin in the house of God. And then as we realize, we say, okay, I want to be holy. And the good news is, you don't have to be holy in your own strength. Just come to the light of God and let God's light change you. Stay long enough. And we have mentioned some of the benefits of the light of God. I only mentioned three things. And number one, it is the source of everything. Number two, it's a source for healing and help. Number three, it's a source of wisdom and knowledge. And just to motivate us to realize, it is good. It is good to come to the light of God. And it's there that we can receive power to be holy. The ability to be holy. The infusion of holiness into our life. So let's all rise together. And we ask the Linus to come and play any worshipful song. And as we rise before God, perhaps there are some things in our life that we are struggling with. Perhaps some things we know that we're not 100% there. God knows, and you don't have to tell anybody, it's between you and God. But God knows. You want the strength of God to overcome. And you want the impartation of God to overcome. And it's what we're going to pray with you. But let's at least make sure that all we need is a willing heart. And the rest, God will give you the strength. God will give you the strength and the power to live the Christian life. I invite Pastor David up here, even as we give that call. And if you need, besides that, one is we want to be holy. We want to be closer with God. And if you've been walking okay with God, praising God, growing, that's fine. But if you particularly need the infusion of strength, then we are here for you, here to pray for you, which other area. Plus, if in one of those three areas you need healing or you need a breakthrough in your life, wisdom, and you still need that light to shine more into your life, we'll be here to pray with you. And let's come before God in repentance, in humility, asking God to help us.
Purify my heart.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let me be as gold. And
anyone else, just keep coming forth and we will pray for you.
Purify my heart. Let me be as gold, pure gold, refine as fire. My heart's one desire is to be to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. Seeks your face, oh. light shine on me. Let your light shine on me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Light of the world, light of the world, you stand out into darkness. Glory is in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth, you of the Lord and be saved. And call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. We call upon his name. Call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. Yeah, yeah. Call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I remain in your light, Lord. I remain in your house, Lord. Shine on me. Let your light shine on my face. Let your light shine in my life. Let your light shine in my My soul, body.